Leviticus chapter 1. We want to talk further about this reality of the burnt offering. And of course, just as a reminder, the burnt offering is one of several offerings that are called the sweet savor offerings. The sweet savor offerings. And we're going to look at a few things right now that'll sort of help us to see that difference and comprehend some of the differences between the sweet savor offerings and the sin offerings. So this is Leviticus chapter 1. And might as well read verse 1 with particular interest in verse 2. And the Lord God called unto Moses and spoke unto him out of the tabernacle of the congregation, saying, Speak unto the children of Israel, and say unto them, If any man of you bring an offering unto the Lord, you shall bring your offering of the cattle, even of the herd and of the flock. And then verse 3, If his offering be a burnt sacrifice of the herd, let him offer a male without blemish. He shall offer it of his own voluntary will at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation before the Lord. I want to emphasize this reality that the sacrifices for sin were mandatory. God told you what to bring, how to bring it, where to bring it, and how to present it. When it came to sins or trespasses, there was no options to it. It was, you bring me Christ and him crucified in this way. You bring me the cross and you bring me the lamb on the cross and it be in this way. But what we're dealing with here in Leviticus chapter 1 is, in the first several chapters, it is dealing with the sweet savor offerings, and none of these sweet savor offerings are over sin or failure or lack. So what does this mean to us? This means that you can be doing good and still need to sacrifice to the Lord. And I'll explain that more, but in other words, we usually think, man, when I mess up, I really need to sacrifice to the Lord. I need to give something to the Lord. But even this word here that we read here in verse 2, the word offering, if any man of you bring an offering, that word offering in the Hebrew is a word that maybe some of you might recognize because it's quoted in the New Testament. It is the word korban. Korban. C-O-R-B-A-N. Excuse me. And the word means a gift. Okay. Now, well, with that thought in mind, I'm not sure if we're going to be bouncing back here real quick, but turn with me to Hebrews chapter 10. And I want to begin to show you this contrast between a sacrifice and a gift. A sacrifice and an offering. Now, how many of you honestly, truthfully, when you've heard the word sacrifice or the word offering, to you it was the same thing? I mean, it was interchangeable. But in the scriptures, it's not so. That sacrifice relates to the sin offerings. And offering relates to a gift. And as I said, we'll explain this in a minute. Hebrews 10, verse 5. Wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he saith, Sacrifice and offerings thou wouldest not, but a body thou hast prepared me. Now, I know that you've more or less skipped the thought of sacrifice and offering, and you've said a body is what this is all about, and you would be correct on many fronts. But it is interesting that the scripture says sacrifices and offerings thou wouldest not. Sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not. but a body thou hast prepared me. Because the sacrifice is speaking of the sin offering and the trespass offering. But when it says offering, it's speaking of the sweet savor offerings, which is the burnt offering, the meal offering or meat offering, depending on what translation you use, and the peace offerings. And it is saying, it could be rightly translated, sacrifice and gifts thou wouldest not. I want Jesus in your flesh. A body thou hast prepared me. I'm not wanting sacrifices out here for sin, and I'm not just wanting gifts. And what you say now, in modern day Christianity, we're all familiar with that, really, if you think about it. We say, we're familiar with the term offering being the word gift. You know how I know? Because when you get ready to take the offering, right? It is, now truthfully, in there is tithes and offerings. The offerings being something above tithes, something that you're just giving. You just feel led to give. You just love the Lord and you wanted to give. Or God blessed you in some way. It's a thank offering, or it's a you know, peace offering, something like that. And the peace offering is never really in the sense of, like, me and God had a problem, and now I'm offering a peace offering. You know, now we're going to smoke the peace pipe, you know. You know, I mean, it's not the same. The peace offering has nothing to do with problems. It has everything to do with recognition of union and oneness and peace, finally. Can anybody say amen to peace in a real way? How about peace, even if you've messed up? Can anybody use some of that? Even that. All right, so here he's using that contrast, and there is, and so now, so because we can get confused with offerings and gifts in terms of taking up an offering, then let's call the offering, the gift, instead of a, you know, that sort of thing, let's call it a present. It would be like showing up at God's door, you know, and I'll use a dumb example, one that doesn't translate quite as well, but it'll be fine. It'd be like showing up at God's door and having flowers behind your back, you know. I mean, I know my wife, I have at different times given her things, flowers or something, you know, and it wasn't scheduled. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Well, you have to do it on Valentine's Day. No, I don't. That's my birthday, so, you know, I get the gift. But anyway, but I mean, you know, we have certain times we say, oh, you have to do it. 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 And if any woman were a thinking woman, I mean, she really thought about it, and she only got stuff on scheduled times, it would bother her a little bit. Because the calendar would be dictating certain things. Am I right? I mean, the calendar, you know, you don't love me, you obey the calendar. Now, I hope I'm not getting some of you guys in trouble with your wives right now. It just occurred to me I might be, but I'm not. That's not the goal. Let's see, Carolyn, leave the room during this time period. No, I know Jim is a sensitive guy. But I mean, it's true. You just show up all of a sudden, you got something, and you say, here, what's this for? Isn't that always the question? What's, yeah. Good one. It's either, oh, what's this for? What did you do? Good one, Jonathan. Good one. That would not fall under the sweet savor offerings. That would be a guilt. That would be a guilt offering. Well, now that you bring it up, true enough, But seeing how that doesn't fall in the category we're talking about, we're going to skip that part. It is just because you love the Lord and it was in your heart to bless him. How about no particular thing? Whoa. Now, I mean, come on. I mean, most Christians respond to Jesus because of particular things. Either salvation or getting filled with the Holy Spirit or getting healed or something big happening. Come on. Oh, thank you, Jesus. But how about just a sweet savor because of him? Just a gift, just a present. Well, that really is sort of the spirit of these sweet savor offerings. And as we've noted, there is a difference between a gift and a sacrifice. And to see that, you know, Jesus sacrificed himself for our sins. And thank God for it. He didn't have to do it, but he sacrificed himself for our sins and our failures. I mean, incredible love that we should have for that. But what if you didn't think about what he saved you from, but just who he is? You see that a lot in the Psalms, don't you? David, constantly in the Psalms, I mean, there are sin offerings in the Psalms. But more than sin offerings, there are sweet savor offerings where David, just out of the blue, he just starts, I wanted to sing a song to you. I wanted to just bless you. I wanted to love on you, Lord, you know. you know, I mean, have you ever just gone to the Lord in prayer and just said, Lord, I don't have needs on my mind. I don't have situations on my mind. I don't have the earth on my mind. I got you on my mind. And I just wanted to, you know, I'll just use the visualization. I just wanted to come into the throne room and just spend some time with you and just tell you I love you because I love you. You know, a present from your heart to him, a gift in that sense. And so, And these verses, by the way, if there's any question that that's what they're talking about, the contrast of sacrifice and offering being sacrifices for sins and burnt offerings, which are sweet savor offerings, then read the very next verse, verse 6. Well, let's read 5 into 6. Wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he saith, sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not, but a body thou hast prepared me in burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin, thou hast had no pleasure. Now, this is the book of Hebrews. This has ripped away, this is the light shining and the shadow. Gosh, it's so hard to explain these things sometimes. Folks, the darkness that many times we want chased out of our life is nothing more than the devil darkness. You know what I'm talking about? But there is a darkness that is shadows of the real that is still not the real Jesus. It's just a shadow. You know? Like I saw this movie called The Fountain, and this guy was trying to hold on to his wife who was about to die. And he was holding on to shadows, and he took an ink pen, and he made a ring because he'd lost his ring, and he made a ring on his finger, and it was just this dark shadow, but it wasn't the real. It wasn't. The union has to be in more than shadows. The reality of oneness with Christ has to be drawn from living wells that actually feed you. Who can do that? I mean, I can stand up here and share, folks, but the truth is I'm not the fountain of living water, am I? Jesus is. And the Holy Spirit opens up those wells. Not me. I mean, I've tried, you know, and I can't do it. I can't do it in me, and I can't do it in you. But the Holy Spirit was sent to do that. Thank God for the Holy Spirit. Thank God I'm not the Holy Spirit, you know. Thank God that he loves to lift up Jesus. And he can do it way better than me or Jim or anybody else around here. And that's why it's so important for you to seek the Lord, apart from classes. Do you understand what I'm saying? To have a heart for the Lord apart from classes. Because you, a lot of the really best things that I've ever gotten of the Lord and known of the Lord and blended into of one heart to another heart has not been in a classroom or a church service. Some of the best of the stuff that I've got that is most precious to me was just my little times with the Lord when I said, I'm going to go after you right now. I'm going to take this time. You know, I'm going to redeem this time and I'm going after you, Jesus. So he clearly is saying here, he is shining the light. And he's shining the light of the knowledge of the glory of God. And he's saying, every burnt offering, no matter how precious it was before this time, every offering for sin, God never really had pleasure in any of it. That really was only a shadow. Amen? That really was only a shadow. But interestingly enough, because if you follow through on this, the full light on this isn't what happened 2,000 years ago, but is what is happening in his body now as Jesus, the burnt offering, is being offered constantly on the altar of our heart to the Father. Wow. The reality. Because it was a daily sacrifice, wasn't it? And it wasn't just daily. It wasn't just a one. It was morning and evening. It was to cover both ends of the spectrum. When there's full-blown light, when there's darkness, we offer, we release the sweet savor of Christ to the Father through these earthen vessels. It's not the earthen vessel that's bringing God glory. We fail. You fail. Has anybody in here failed besides me? We fail, and it hurts, and it's miserable, and it's hard, and it rips your heart out. But you not failing is still not the sweet savor. It's Christ in you that's going to be the sweet savor. God's not saying, I don't want failure. He's not saying that to you. He's not looking at you and saying, I'm sick of your failure. He's looking at you and saying, I want more of Jesus. John said it best. He must increase. I must decrease. I can see in John, it was Greg when he was here. He came up afterwards and he was talking about that. And he said, we never see the New Testament verses that are so precious. We never see them in light of a fulfillment of the Old Testament. We just read them as fact. And he said, but that verse that says he must increase and I must decrease, New Testament verse, is nothing more than the offering of the burnt offering, where the bullock or the lamb or the turtle dove or whatever is burned up in its outward form, and the essence, the sweet savor of that, which is Christ, rises and it fills the nostrils of God. And God says, I smell Jesus. That's, folks, the greatest honor God could ever say to you is not, well done, thou good and faithful servant. The greatest honor God could ever say to you is look at you and say, this is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. And he's pointing to Jesus in you. Because he loves the Lord and he wants us to love the Lord and he wants us to be a sweet. He wants us to be in the old covenant or when the high priest went behind the veil. He didn't just walk in there and dance around and do stuff like most Christians do on Sunday or whatever. There was an incense burner. There was a carrier of that sweet savor, and he came in and that high priest filled that holy of holies with that so much that it covered him over, and there was nothing the Lord couldn't see. The high priest, he only smelled Christ, and that kept him from dying. Isn't that something? You and I will be struck dead if we go in there on our own merits. Well, I'm doing good today, so I thought I'd spend time with you. You know what I mean? I mean, think about it. You know, he goes, you just killed me for doing good. And he might say something like, wrong tree. the knowledge of good and evil. You know, wrong tree. I want life. I want my son. I want Jesus formed in you. Hallelujah. So he clearly is saying here that whether it's Old Testament sacrificing or New Testament sacrifice. Okay, well, I'll give up. How about this? I'll give up 3 years to come to Bible school. But you see, he's not wanting you to give up 3 years. He's wanting you to know the Lord and to grow in the Lord and let there be an increase of him to the Father. Yes, it may take 3 years, or it may take a period of time of saturating and seeking and wanting the Lord. And because the truth is, I mean, you know, you can have holy oil poured out on a table, and if you have a dry rag and you just barely set it on the table, and the oil is all over most of the table, but there's a corner that's dry and you barely set the rag, if that rag is just soaking up just a little bit on the corner, well, that, how long could that take? Well, you know, it could take 3 years to get just a little. So, or you can just take that rag and immerse it and say, I give you 3 years to fill me with Jesus and to saturate me so that when I get out of here, when I run for my life, I'll have something to give somebody else. Because all this teaching is not going to be enough. It's not enough. I'm telling you, I've been doing it for years. It's not enough. I need more of Jesus. You need more of Jesus. We do. There is a desperate need, not because of failure. I know our failures sometimes drive us to the Lord, and that's fine. But when will we move past the sin offerings and not have to find our motivation because we fail? Okay, well, when I'm not failing, I'm not motivated towards the Lord. I mean, could you see that could be possible? That you're actually not really as hot? You know, what did Jesus say? I'd rather you be hot or cold. I don't want you lukewarm. Well, that's unlike most of Christianity. Christianity says, I'd rather you be, you know, I'd rather you be hot or lukewarm, but not cold. Am I right or wrong? Jesus is more opposed to lukewarm. In other words, he's more opposed to throwing a dry rag on there and it just kind of getting some. Just immerse. Just, you know, that's why Baptist folks, I was raised United Methodist. And in the United Methodist Church, when you get baptized, you know how they do it? You walk up, and they got a little bowl of water, and they go like this, and they sprinkle it on your head, and they say, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And if you're lucky, you know, if your hair's not fluffy and saturate, then maybe one drop might run down, you know, and you go, oh, I'm really getting it now. Well, I mean, this was of interest to me because, and I'm not putting them down, I'm trying to make a point, and that was, When I got saved then later, because I wasn't saved when I was in the United Methodist Church, when I got saved later, I thought, should I get rebaptized? And so I started searching the scriptures about baptism, and I saw that they only had one form in the New Testament, and it was immersion. Well, that caught my attention right there. First of all, I'd never heard of immersion. You know, I didn't hang out with Baptists or Pentecostals or anything. All I ever heard of was you get a little wet on your head right there, you know. And so I saw that they went down, and they went not just down, but they went under. That's, folks, that's total saturation. And some of you who have been baptized by me and Jim and other people, we make sure all of you go under. We do. I mean, you know, we put them down, raised them up, and said, hold your breath again. You know, make sure, you know. Because it needs to be total immersion. God set it up that way. That's not just something that we're, you know, somebody says, well, you people there at New Creation, you're just a bunch of fanatics. Well, you know, the word fanatic is nothing more than the word fan. I mean, really, I mean, anybody a sports fan or sports fanatic? Are you ashamed of being called a sports fan? Well, I'm a Jesus fan, you know. And I remember Paul says that, you know, he's writing to people and he said, and I write to those who are addicted to the ministry to the saints. My God, I've done drugs, folks. I've done some major drugs. I have 2 felonies on my record over drugs, not misdemeanors. 2 felonies in Texas, 1 more, and you're up in prison for life. You'll never get out again. Huh? I know about drugs, you know, and I know about addiction. But when I met Jesus, I realized, you know, my silly way of putting it then was, I used to get high, but now I found the most high. And that is the way I would say it. You know, I was a hippie, okay? Give me a break. But, that's how, you know, dude, you know. You know, they say, would you like to drop some acid and stuff? Man, I used to, you know. Yeah, there's no high like the most high, you know. I mean, but I remember before that saying, you know, what was it? It was the one I said to you just the other day. Oh, there ain't no hope without dope. That was my phrase before I came to Jesus. There ain't no hope without dope. Well, you know what? There wasn't at that time. I mean, drugs really did help me. No, they did. They helped me out of an ugly home life with 2 parents that were alcoholics and fought. And when I say fought, I mean bloodletting, fighting, and screaming, and horrors in the night, and all sorts of stuff. And, you know, crashing, throwing junk, and knocking out windows, and bashing each other's head through windows and stuff like that, and bashing our heads as little kids, you know, stuff like that. Drugs really were like the best thing that happened to me. I mean, I started feeling good, you know, and in school, they said to me, drugs are bad. And I said, no. No, drugs are good. You know, until I met Jesus, you know, I didn't realize there was a higher high. And I know that's a sort of a very small way of putting it. But for me at that time particularly, it was like, my God, I actually feel good on the inside, and it didn't go down. I mean, one of the reasons why I dropped acid was because, or did speed, you know, took some speed and stuff, because it'd keep you up for a long time, and you'd feel good for long periods. Not just like, you know, I mean, marijuana was fine, you know, and smoke it, but, you know, then I'd just sit there like this for an hour, you know, or 2 or 3 or whatever, you know. You want to hit another hit? Yeah. You know, would somebody change the record, you know, put on something else? I can't. Well, let's just have a moment of silence. You know. You know, I mean, I know all about that, but Jesus starts changing stuff on the inside. Thank God, because, and I don't, you know what, I don't even claim I'm totally healed on the inside, but I know the healer. You know what I mean? I mean, I know he's the healer, and I know, and you know what, I know I'm not the healer. Not for me and not for you. I know who the only one who is the healer, and that's Jesus. And he can do it, and he will do it, and he desires to do it. He desires to bring forth, and the Father is giving us his best. I mean, think of it. With as much as we've messed up, he could have just sent an angel. He said, hey, you know, Bill, come here. I'm not sending Gabriel or Michael. I'm going to send Bill the angel. Bill, go down there and just help them people. They're a mess. Just go help them, you know. Or, you know, you hear so much about angels and guardian angels. Well, I'm just going to have an army of guardian angels. And then when you're about to have a car wreck, I'll save you. And when you're about to mess up, I'll have them slap you on the head or something, you know. Wow, what was that? It's the angel Bill, you know. But I'm really trying to make you think. But instead, God put his son, he didn't just give his son, he put his son on the inside of us. That's cool. I mean, that's just totally cool, because there's a whole new motivation. There's a whole new life. There's a whole new level than my level with Bill trying to straighten me out. You know, an angel's just a messenger. Jesus is the message. Amen? I mean, consider it. In these verses, it goes on to say, we read verse 6, in burnt offering sacrifices for sin, thou hast had no pleasure. Then said I, lo, I come. In the volume of the book it is written to me. When Hebrews was written, there was only one book, the Old Testament. Am I right or wrong? Jesus said, in the volume of the Old Testament, it's written to me. I'm not talking about burnt offerings. I'm not talking about sin offerings. I'm not talking about trespasses. I'm talking about my son coming in a body, and we are that body. We are the body of Christ. Are we not? We are the body. Yes, he did come in a physical body, but folks, I'm going to tell you this. Even his physical body was only the tabernacle. He tabernacled among us. It says that. The literal Greek in John, the Gospel of John, the first chapter is that he came and he dwelt among us. The word there is actually he tabernacled among us. Folks, the tabernacle wasn't the end all. The temple was. Amen? The tabernacle was still moving around and didn't have a permanent setting and didn't have a permanent place. We are the temple of God. We are the body that he wanted all along. And the proof of that is Jesus only ministered and showed himself in his physical earth tabernacle for 3.5 years. He lived in it for 30 years, but he only showed himself and ministered to people and used it for God in a manifest outward way 3.5 years, that's all. That's about the time some of you will graduate Bible school. Jesus did his whole life ministry. Do you see how important it is to give yourself to 3 years? To give yourself, you know? He spent it. He spent his body. He spent it so that he could finally get the body he wanted, us. No shadows. Finally reached the end of the progression. They came out of Egypt and they had a little tabernacle. But when they entered into the promised land, they built a temple. David built that temple. Well, sort of. There's much to all of that. So he's saying, you know, God didn't want this. God didn't want that. Those were all shadows. Everything is a shadow until Christ comes and becomes the fulfillment of it in us. Can you see that that's the case here? I come in the volume of the book. It is written to me to do thy will, O God. Above, when he said sacrifice and offerings, that is, burnt offerings and offerings for sin, thou wouldest not, neither hast pleasure in them which are offered by the law. Then said I, lo, I come to do thy will. I come to do thy will. Do you see that the offerings in those things were, they said, we're doing God's will. Okay, here's how you do it. I'm going to do God's will, and here's how I do it. I stand here, and God gives me the tools. He says, make an altar, get you a bullock, get you a knife and do it this way and lay the wood in order and kill it and burn it. And the man would say, I'm doing the will of God. But he was doing the will of God in that ritual, in that thing, but his heart was still himself. When Jesus comes in the body, now Jesus does his will through us. Thy kingdom come in earth, not on earth. You know, it's not like Jesus was walking around on our earth. He did, but now, you know, he's not walking around on our earth. He's walking in us. He said, I will come and dwell in them and walk in them. I mean, think of that. He didn't say, I'm going to come dwell with them and walk with them. He said, I will dwell in them. I will walk in them. And that whole reality begins to be the fulfillment, not just going to a temple. See? I mean, think about it. Think about New Testament Christianity has not come to the New Testament if we're still going to a temple and not being that temple for his life, for his expression. Who expresses themselves through your temple, through your body? Well, how about sometimes you do? Anybody that way? Sometimes you're busy expressing yourself. Maybe like 75% of the time. Maybe the only time people think of expressing Christ is in a church service instead of being the church. Could it be? In a church service, I'm gonna be with God. Lord, I'm your yielded vessel. Folks, you're supposed to be his yielded vessel. You're supposed to be his altar of burnt offerings 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. That's the real, not the shadow. We've come to the real. Anybody glad that we finally reached the new covenant? Well, this is what he's talking about here is the new covenant. And then verse 10 says, by which will we are sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. I thought it was interesting that it says we're sanctified because justification is an act of justifying sinners. Okay, before I say all that, let me just say this. Is there a difference between justification and sanctification? Well, okay, let's say it like this. Do you think there might be a difference between justification and sanctification? There sure is. That's exactly right. Justification is what is done through a sacrifice for you to get you right with God. It is bringing two enemies together. It is justifying you where God will even talk to you. But sanctification, folks, is separating you unto him, not because of sin, but as a person, you're being drawn more and more to him. You could almost say it like this: I am more a Jesus person than I am a world person. I am being drawn into realms and realities. See, it's different than just being a saved person that's going to get a ministry one day. Does anybody see what I'm talking about? I mean, you can be a saved person and go, I'm just a person on the earth, and then I'm going to minister for God. But to be sanctified, folks, is being separated unto the oneness that he has made you, where you begin to act like, you begin to be in oneness of accord with him. Your mind is being renewed. You're changing not out of something now, but into something. You're being transformed. I went and saw that movie the other night, The Transformers. And I thought when I saw it was like a car and then it goes. I thought that's cool. But I thought there ain't no transformation like being changed from me to Jesus, you know, for really Christ to be formed in me, taking more and more ground. You know, it's like Israel going into the promised land and taking it from the enemy. Well, Jesus is the name Jesus, and Joshua is the same name. Joshua is the Old Testament name, the Hebrew, and Jesus is the New Testament, but it's the same name. Jesus, Joshua, is coming in and taking the land and getting the enemies out. Is that good news to anybody? He's driving them out, baby. He's coming in and he's taking over, you know. You know, we're all wanting Jesus to take charge. He doesn't take charge. He takes over. You know, and the sad thing is, though, in many cases, he's coming in, and we're happy when he takes away some of the junk that was messing with us and we didn't like, but when he starts looking at us like we're the enemy, you know what I'm saying? And then we start resisting Jesus. Oh, no, you know, it's like we've got all these rooms, and Jesus, when he first got saved, came in and he cleaned out the big room, you know? And then he's come and he's cleaned out a few closets. But then after years, he comes and he starts heading toward this one door. We know what's in there, but no one else knows. Oh, the evil that lurks behind door number two. And just as his nail-scarred hand is about to grab the doorknob, we stick our hand in. No, there's nothing in there. Don't need to go in there. Let's go clean the carpet. You know, we try to divert him. Oh, look over here, Jesus. Or, oh, help me. I really got this other problem. I really need you now. Pray for me, Lord. Come on, take the hand and pray for me. Okay, let's pray over here. Well, he doesn't have a mean bone in his body. But we're afraid. We're afraid he's going to take something from us. And we don't know what true transformation is. You know? I mean, that car was pretty cool. It was. The first one, anybody that saw it, the first one was this beat up old yellow Camaro. But it was cool. I mean, I loved to hear those 60s cars. You know, I was a teenager in the 60s. I loved to hear them carburetors, man, a big old, and the sound of those mufflers, you know, vroom, vroom. I mean, nowadays, the Jap cars go, you know, I mean, that's the sound, you know. But those cars, I mean, they were just, you know, you could feel them in your chest, you know, when you're driving, you know. So I liked hearing that, but I tell you what, that wasn't nothing compared to when it transformed into Bumblebee or whatever his name was. You know, and he's this bot that could do all this stuff, man, and had these guns, grrr, you know, all this stuff. That's, you know, it's cool that we're a beat-up Camaro, but we've got some gumption. It's more cool when we've got the power of Christ flowing through us to make us free. I know we want to be free from all of the bad guys, but we need to be free from the good guys. We need to be free from having to worry about anything or anybody, you know. I mean, I was raised in an orphanage. Before that, I lived in 3-4 foster homes. You know, doggone it, my parents, and it wasn't even my real dad. I mean, he left when I was like 1 or something like that, and it's my stepfather. You know, I could spend my life blaming my stepfather. Ugh, bad man. Ugh, ugh. I mean, I've got reason. I've got some reasons, folks. I could tell you some real stories. But you know, I got the blessing of leading him to the Lord like 4 days before he died, and we didn't even know he was dying. Didn't even know he was dying. I didn't know he was dying. After years, after I got saved, and I decided, you know, my father told me, my heavenly father said, you need to love that man. He's hurting on the inside. And, you know, he said, that's why he's the way he is. He just hurts. So I'd walk in the door, and he'd be sitting there at the table in the old house I grew up in. I'd walk up behind him. He'd hear me coming. I'd put my arms around him. I'd just hug him real big. I'd say, I love you. I'd go sit down. And he'd say, yeah, I know you do, but I don't want you talking about Jesus in my house. That's what he told me. I don't want you talking about Jesus in my house. You're going to come into my house, you ain't going to talk about Jesus. I said, No problem. And I went back over and gave him a big hug. No problem. You know, there was even a few times I kissed him on the head. Now, I got brothers and sisters that would have taken an axe to his head. You've got to know my family, but man, you know. But Jesus changed my heart for him. And so years I would walk into that house to come visit for years and sit down and not mention Jesus and just love him, say you need that coffee refreshed or something like that. Go over there, put some coffee in it. 3-4 days before he died, he calls me up. I'm working with JW out here in Decatur. Calls me up and he said, Randy, I'd like for you to come tomorrow. Tomorrow's Saturday. I'd like for you to come and tell me about the Jesus that you know. That's what he said to me. In fact, you know what? It wasn't tomorrow. I think it was right then. I think I jumped in my car and went right then. He said, and he was specific, I don't want to know about Jesus, but I want to know about the Jesus you know. And I jumped in my car and tears were running down my cheeks and I'm driving and I'm, you know, going as fast as I can in my Camaro. Actually, it was at that time, it was a VW camper. It was 1960 something. No, I guess it's early 70s or whatever by then. Anyway, got there, went in, shared the Lord with him. He started crying. I said, you want to receive Jesus in your heart? And he said, yes. And he said, I want to be baptized. And by then he was pretty large. I said, I don't know that I can do it here. I said, but we're going to do something. I went in and I got some water and I did that thing, but I did say this. I said, Father, this represents to our hearts total immersion in Jesus. And we acknowledge the death and resurrection of your son and our oneness with him in resurrection. And I told my stepfather, just believe that, and did that. And he looked at me and I had my Bible with me and I said, you know, do you have a Bible? And he said, no. And I said, I'd really like for you to read it. And he said, I will. And I said, I'm going to bring you one next time I come. I'm going to come next whenever. It was going to be within 4 days. Next call I got was that he died. He was with the Lord. You know. Well, you know, I could have stood over his grave and spit on it, and you know. I mean, my family was so wild. This is, you know, I'm sorry I'm telling all these family stories, but some of them are funny. My mom used to say to me, you know, because I was such a hellraiser, my mom said to me once, she said, Randy, one day when you die, I'm going to dance on your grave. She was only playing, but she's like, you know, when you die, I'm going to be so happy. In other words, I'm going to be so happy. I'm going to dance on your grave. And I said, good, Mom, because I'm going to be buried at sea. And then we both laugh and everything. But, I mean, it's, you know, it's some wild up and down. You know, I could blame him. I could blame her. I could blame, you know, you can just blame. But, man. To be free, my God, to be free. True freedom, not just free from hell. Free from bad people, free from good people. Free to be who God made you to be and to live Christ through whom God made you to be. You're not supposed to be me. And I have no desire to make you in my image. But I do want you to be you. That's only one part, because it's Christ in you, the hope of glory. It's not just Christ, the hope of glory. He already had Christ, did he not? He's always had Christ. The Father's always had Christ. His goal isn't just Christ, because before the world was, here's Christ sitting at his right hand. I've got it. You know, he could just do this. I got it. Why go through this mess? But he wanted you. He wanted, but not just you, he wanted Christ in you. But he wanted you. Listen to my words. He did want you. He likes your personality. He made you that way. Quit worrying about what other people are like. Don't try to be like other people. Be you. You'll always, if you try to be like other people, you'll always be faking it, and you'll never be true to who you are. Just be you. You're okay. You're just fine. You're what you're supposed to be. Don't think that, don't do this deluded thing of looking at someone else and thinking, you know, if I could only be like them. And don't, you know, I've had people say to me, oh, if I could only have your life. I thought, you don't want my life. You don't want my life. You do not want my life. And you don't want to be like me. You need to be you. And you need to find Jesus real for you. And you need to spend your life being who you are with the sweet fragrance of Christ coming out of you. But be who you are. Be you. Hallelujah. I mean, isn't that beautiful, though, that God knows us and made us just like that? You know, it's hard with all these commercials and stuff, you know. I mean, all the girls are a certain weight, and they all look a certain way, and they're, you know, oh, I just love her hair. Anybody ever said that? Any girl ever looked at another girl and said, oh, I just love her hair. I wish I had hair like that. You know, I'm just, when I said that, I looked up and saw Kelly sitting back there, and I thought, you know, surely some girl said, oh, I wish I had hair like that. But, you know, I'm just guessing. Kelly, you tell me if this is the truth. I'm guessing shower time is probably sort of tough, having to wash all that hair, huh? How about brushing it out and all of that? Let me ask you this. Have you ever had plumbing problems in the place that you live? Massive hair clogging up the sinks and stuff. You know, but we have a romantic view of something. You know, some of you probably, especially you girls, probably don't even see Kelly walking like she normally does. You see her, and the wind is blowing. And it's like, well, it's just not true, you know. I mean, I don't know why we're on all this stuff tonight, but we are, so we're going to be on it. Most of you have no clue what this girl was like when she first came here. No. I'm serious. You talk about serious problems? Serious, deep-rooted. Oh, man, she was messed up. Well, I'm glad to say that I fixed her. No, of course not. How absolutely ridiculous. It's Jesus. And it's Jesus, 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 and it's always going to be Jesus. We've got to get hold of him, and we got to do it, because remember what it said about the burnt offering. You have to do it voluntarily, of a willing heart. You have to want the Lord. When it comes to the sin offering, baby, you better give him what he wants, or you can die. You spend eternity in hell. Am I right or wrong? But when it comes to these offerings, it has to be a willing heart. You have to say, Lord, I want you. I'm going to go after you. And I know that almost, you know, basically everybody in this room has done that. I mean, you wouldn't even be here if you didn't have. I know that you wouldn't have put up with this place for 1 week if you didn't have a heart after Jesus. I believe that. I believe it's only Jesus that keeps a person here, or the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit holding you here. Not because this place is special or whatever, but because it is one of the few places that you can go separate for a while and just get in the Word. And, you know, that's all. And maybe even find a little peace, you know, without everything pulling on you, without your job saying 24 hours a day, you know, you got to do this, you got to do that, you got to, you know, and pulling, and life pulls. Did you not know that? Some of the people who are older here know that. Man, golly, it's always demanding your time. Here, the mother with three kids breaks down and laughs because she doesn't want to cry. You know, I mean, she's literally seeing the pulling, you know. She can feel the pulling. Mommy, come here. Mommy, I need this. Mommy, would you give me that? Mommy, would you wipe my face? Would you do this? Would you clean up this? Mommy, I just threw up. You know? Well, why would somebody like that even be here? You know, if nothing else, just a little peace every once in a while. Hallelujah. But I believe because a heart after Jesus, a desire to really know the Lord. Why? Because there's going to come a day, folks, listen to me, when this nice little quiet time is going to be over, and you will not believe, you know, what does it say that life abhors a vacuum? Soon as you step out of this Bible school, man, things are going to be rushing at you, pulling you and everything. And I remember, this is an honest thing. This is from my heart. I remember when I graduated from Bible school and we were sent, Deb and I were sent, we got married and then how many months later? 3 months later, we're on the mission field. Graduated from Bible school, got married, and we're on the mission field in 3 months. And there it was constant. 5 a.m, you know, you get up, you go to bed at midnight. We had an orphanage, we had a school, and I pastored 3 churches. And it was daily, and you're on an island. There's not even a thought. I can run down to McDonald's and sit down for a while and get a cup of coffee and just think. Where we were at, we were back off in the bush. There was nothing. Just you stuck there every day. And the day that you woke up screaming, you can scream all you want, but you cannot get off that island by running at that moment. You know, it's got you. You know. And I remember thinking, I am so glad I spent 3 years seeking the Lord. And getting certain things in me and getting a certain stability in me, because what I gained in those 3 years is keeping me right now. I remember thinking that. And I remember being so happy. I'm serious. I remember just going, oh, thank you. Deb, do you remember me even saying that? I'm sure you do. I thought, I am so thankful I didn't, because there were people in the Bible school. We had hundreds, though. We had hundreds in the Bible school. But there were people in the Bible school, they just frittered away their time. Man, they weren't serious. It was like, you know, they were just there. And I bet you're glad you gained some stuff and then you got sent to Phoenix and thought, man, thank God, you know. I mean, it just makes a difference. So I'm just going to close with this and just say, you know, several things that the Lord's been pointing out. One is, God wants you to be you, not anyone else. God wants it to be Christ in you, and for that to happen, it's going to take the Holy Spirit through the revelation of Christ, and no man, not me, nor anyone else can trigger that. The Bible says when the heart turns to the Lord. It's your own heart. You have to do that. And you know what? I promise you, if you start seeing Jesus, I'll never take credit for it. In other words, I won't go, yeah, it's my great teacher. Yeah, I'm the one. I promise you, because I know that if I could put it in somebody, I'd already put it in most of you. You know, and I can't. I'm just not smart enough or good enough or, you know, whatever. But the Holy Spirit is, and he's the one sent here to help you. So cry out from your heart. This is a personal thing. And spend time with the Lord, and don't let this time slip away, because it's a gift from God. It really is. All right, let's take a break and we'll come back in about 10 minutes.